Amen. So did you come expecting to hear from God today? Yeah. Did you come ready to be transformed? I believe if you came expecting, then that's what's going to happen. But if you came just to be part of a service, then that's what's going to happen as well, too. So I pray that you came for a little bit more than that. You know, speaking of transformation, I heard about an old country guy and his son. They went to the city, and they'd never been to the city before. And especially, they'd never been to the city, and they'd never been inside the mall before. And so this was the first time they'd walked into a mall, and they looked around, and they just was overwhelmed by just all the people that were in the mall walking around. And they were just looking at everything, and they were just amazed at everything that they saw. But one of the biggest things that just totally amazed them, and they couldn't get over, is this father and son stood by this wall with these shiny silver doors. And they sat there and looked at this wall, and this wall would open up and it would shut back again. And the little boy asked his dad, he said, "Paul," he said, "have you ever saw this before? What is this?" And he looked at his son. He said, "Son, I've never seen anything like it before. I have no idea what that is." So they just kept there staring at the wall, you know, and they watched it open and they watched it shut. And finally they saw this older lady come in, and she's in a wheelchair. She couldn't even move. And she wheeled up next to that wall that opens up and reaches up there and pushes the button. All of a sudden that wall goes open and she wheels herself in, and the door goes back shut again. And they're sitting there just looking, because they saw this little cubicle there that she went into. They're trying to figure it out, and all of a sudden they see these lights go up. Each one blink on and off, and they get all the way to the top one, and then they see it go all the way back down. And they were just wondering what the heck was going on. And as they continued to watch, this door opens up, and out walks this beautiful 24-year-old young lady. And the man looked at his son, and his eyes got real big, and he said, "Boy, go get your mama." Hey, that's what you get if you come to our church, right? Terrible jokes. Now, that's transformation. Amen. I'm going to talk about transformation today, okay? I'm going to talk a little bit about transformation and what that looks like. But the transformation that I'm going to talk about today is not just a physical transformation. It's not just a transformation that is going to tell you how to find the fountain of youth and how to look younger. I'm not going to tell you that we need to just put a little more makeup on so we can hide our wrinkles. I'm not going to tell you that it's about coloring our hair so the gray doesn't show. I could probably use a little bit of color, though. I'm sure the sunlight is shining off my gray. You know, it's amazing the people that I see that I haven't saw for a while, and they'll look at me, and one of the first things they'll say is, "Wow, you've got a lot of gray hair now." That's one of the first things they say. I say, try starting a church. You'll have this kind of gray hair in 3 years too. Amen? But the transformation that I'm talking about, it's not a physical transformation that I'm talking about. You know, the ones that I'm talking about is transformation that starts with on the inside. It's an inside transformation, that inside transformation, whenever it's real, it will absolutely move to the outside. It will move to the outside and will absolutely be evident to all. Have you ever heard somebody talk about somebody that's been a real nice person, and they'll say, "You know what, that person or that lady, she's beautiful from the inside out." Have you ever heard somebody say that before about somebody? We probably have, haven't we? They're talking about that person is beautiful from the inside out. What they're saying is the outward appearance is not the only thing that makes that person attractive. It's because that person's got a good heart. It's that because that person's a nice person, and that niceness that they have, it kind of overflows from the outside, and it makes that person even that much more attractive on the outside. That's the kind of transformation that I'm going to talk about. It's the outward inward transformation that's going to work its way to the outside and be changed in life. See, I believe that God wants us all to be beautiful from the inside out. Amen. Do you want to be beautiful from the inside out? Amen. I got 6 people on this front row that wants to be beautiful from the inside out. Guys, I am not above begging for amens, okay? I will do that, especially with a crowd this large. Do you want to be transformed and beautiful from the inside out? Amen. You know, I have every single bit of desire to be beautiful from the inside out. I want to be transformed on the way that God's going to do something amazing in my life, so it's evident in other people's life in the way that we live. And that only happens by what we're going to visit with today. And that's a total transformation when we're forever changed, because I believe that God wants to do that in our life. And I believe that when we're transformed from the inside out, I believe that that's where real life begins. Amen. I believe that that's where it's really time to start living. See, a lot of of us think living is so much different. We all got our view of living and what we have fun doing and what living really looks like. But I believe when God gets a hold of your life, then we really start living. And that's where our life starts changing and things start looking a lot different. For those of you that are guests here today, you know, for the last several weeks, we've been looking at a sermon series called Colliding with God. And we've kind of split this up into three different parts. And in the first part that we talked about in Colliding with God, we kind of talked about the mission of Lifepoint Church, why we exist and what our mission is that we believe that God's called us to do. Let me just fill you in on what I believe God's called us to do as a church. You know, in the surrounding county in Chillicothe and the surrounding areas, there's about 15,000 people that don't go to church. On any given Sunday, you can do the math at the churches. On any given Sunday, there's about 3,000 people that go to church. So where's the other 12,000 people? Where are they at? They're probably in bed sleeping in, right? They don't have a need. They don't have a desire to go anywhere else. I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt, God's given us a mission to go reach them. I believe He's given us a mission to go reach them and to tell them the good news about Jesus Christ. So we looked at the mission of Lifepoint Church. And then we went on in part two and we looked at three messages concerning the vision of Lifepoint Church. You know, I believe that our vision basically boils down to God's called us as a church. He's given us a vision as a church. And who's the church? You are the church. We are the church. All together, we're the church. And I believe that God's called us to be people that look pure, real, and simple before a community that desperately needs to hear the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? And when I'm talking about pure, that means that every single one of us should have a desire to look like Jesus. Do you know that as a believer in Christ, as somebody that has said that they accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior, do you know at that moment you give your life to Jesus and you say, God, transform me? Look at my life and show me the things in my life that doesn't look like you. At that given time, we become ambassadors for Jesus Christ. We become ambassadors for Him, and our message is to share the gospel with others in the way that we live and the way that we seek and the way that we speak. So I believe that God's called us to be people that desire to be pure, and I hope that that's your desire today. I didn't say perfect. I said have a desire to be more Christ-like and to be pure. But I also believe that we need to be real, meaning that let's be authentic, right? Let's be genuine. Let's be true. Let's not be people that go around like a fakeness on us. You understand? You guys like to be around people that are real. Amen? Amen. You like to be around people that are genuine. Have you been around somebody fake before? It's not very fun, is it? You can kind of see right through them. So let's be people that are real. Let's be people that are real and admit when we mess up in life. Let's be transparent and authentic in everything we do. But then let's all also be simple in our faith. And when I say simple in our faith, I don't mean that we don't grow of our knowledge in Christ. I want us to grow in our walk. But when I say simple, it means that, you know what? Jesus Christ died for us. Amen? We're all sinners and we need Him. And He came and He died and He rose from the grave. And the Bible says that if we believe that and confess that with our mouth, we'll be saved. And then we need to go around and return and we need to tell the stories to other people. That's the simple gospel message. And I believe that when we let God be in our life, let's not overcomplicate life and cause extra drama. Amen? Amen. Let's just live our lives pure, real, and simple. And I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt, the community will see that and they will want what you have. Today, we're going to continue on. And I believe that if we're faithful to the mission that God's called us to, I believe that if we're faithful to the vision that God's called us to, then the people in this great community will experience the impact that God's going to have on their life. Amen? So we're going to look at several messages coming up in the next several weeks about the impact that God has on people's life. When people experience Jesus in a different way, they're impacted. So we're going to look at several different places in the Bible where people encountered Jesus and how their life changed and how real life began for them and they were forever changed. Guys, forever changed is the name of the message because that's what Christianity is all about. That's what it's all about. It's about being forever changed. You know, Christianity is all about conversion and transformation. That's all what Christianity is all about. Everything that we say, everything that we believe, everything that we do, it's sold on this one undeniable, solid truth that you don't have to stay the same. Amen. Amen. You do not have to stay the same. That's what Christianity is all about. Your life can be radically changed forever. You see, conversion is something that's supernatural. It's something that's supernatural that takes place on the inside of you. And it's actually a miracle. Salvation is a miracle from God. And it's something that's supernatural that takes place on the inside of a person. And when their life, when the personality of God collides with you, then everything changes. Everything changes. That's why we use the speech collide with God. See, I don't want us to just touch base with God. All of us can touch base, right? We can touch base, give each other a high five. That's not change. That's not when real change happens. But when God collides with you, real life change. And at that point, and that point of impact, God begins transforming your life and nothing stays the same. Nothing stays the same. God is going to wreck your life if you've truly given him your life. He just absolutely is. But he's going to wreck it in a good way. Amen? Amen? For those of you that know Jesus, he's going to wreck it in a good way. Your life will not be the same. Long-held prejudice will be overcome. Lifetime habits will be broken. Deep ingrained sins can be erased. Marriages can be healed. Broken homes can be restored. Relationships can be mended. And much, much more. The list goes on and on and on. Colliding with God is the certainty. It's the certainty that what you were does not determine what you are. Amen? What you were does not determine what you are. And what you are does not determine what you will be. Amen? Amen. I'm going to say that again for those of you that was too hot and too sleepy. What you were does not determine what you are. And what you are does not determine what you will be. Amen. Your life can absolutely change. It can absolutely change in every single way. You can be different and your life can move in a complete different direction. Listen, guys, if we take that one truth away from Christianity, then it ceases to be supernatural. It just absolutely ceases to be supernatural if we take that truth away. If the possibility of total transformation and real change is gone, then it becomes nothing more than a bunch of religious rules. Amen? It becomes nothing more but a bunch of religious rules. I don't know about you, but I needed to have my life transformed by something supernatural. Amen? You know, before 16 years ago, before I got saved, you know, I've shared the story before, I was an alcoholic. I bet you there wasn't probably two nights out of the week that I didn't drink. All the time. It caused damage in my life. It caused damage in my family. It caused damage in my marriage. It made me a terrible parent. It was terrible. I wrecked cars. I'd gotten DWIs. I had to go to classes on that. Can I tell you there wasn't a single thing, there's not a rule that anybody could have gave me that made me stop drinking. I thank God that salvation and conversion and transformation is supernatural. I'm thankful that God delivered me from that. I'm thankful that I haven't had a drop for 16 years. I'm thankful that my parents got a new son and my wife got a new husband and my kids got a new daddy. See, that doesn't happen with religious rules. Nobody convinced me that I needed to do something different. It was the Holy Spirit getting on the inside of me and changing me and totally transforming me from the inside out. From the inside out. See, that's what God wants to do in every single one of our lives. He wants to totally transform us by something supernatural, and that's His Holy Spirit. Today, we're going to look at the greatest conversion and total transformation stories in all of the Bible. It's the greatest story that I believe that has to do with this. And then several weeks, we're going to look at several more. But in this story, we're going to look at Saul of Tarsus. Raise up your hand if you've heard of Saul of Tarsus before. We're going to talk about Saul of Tarsus and when he collided with God. That collision caused Saul to be supernaturally transformed. Saul later on became known as the Apostle Paul. Now, how many of you have heard of the Apostle Paul before? Amen. See, he was Saul of Tarsus before that, but he was supernaturally transformed and he was forever changed. This conversion, in fact, it's so amazing that the Bible talks about it in three different places in Scripture. But we're actually going to look at the Scripture in Acts 9. So if you have your Bibles, this is the first one that's recorded. You can open it up to Acts 9, and we're going to be in verses 1 through 9. If you don't have your Bibles, we do have it in the bulletin too, so you can follow along with me in that. Starting with verse 1, it says, "Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. And he went to the high priest and he asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way." Now, this is before they started calling them Christians. I'm going to pull over here for just a second because I do find it pretty interesting. Do you know who started calling Christians Christians? The people that weren't Christians. Did you know that? That's how Christians got their name. They started saying that group of people, they looked like Christ. They're followers of him, so they started calling them Christians because they look like them. Nowadays, us Christians call ourselves Christians, but the lost world don't think we look anything like Christ. Do we got that backwards? Do people know that you're a Christian by the way you look, by the way you act, by the way you speak, by the way you do things? So now let's get back into this. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, that he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him, and he fell to the ground, and he heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" And he said, who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." Verse 7, the men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but they did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. So the first thing that we need to learn here, considering the life that has been forever changed, is number one in your outline, is we are all hopeless on our own. We are all hopeless on our own. Guys, listen to me on this. The truth for truth, supernatural transformation to happen in our lives, it is critical that we understand this truth. We have to understand that we are hopeless on our own. You know, there's several scriptures in the Bible that even back this up and to talk about this. Just a couple of scriptures I'm going to throw out there. Romans 3:10 says this, "There is no one righteous, not even one." Not a single one. Does that mean Billy Graham and Mother Teresa? Yeah, that's what that means, isn't it? No one is righteous, not even one. And then in Romans 3:23, the scripture says, the Apostle Paul says, we've all sinned and fall short of the glory. Every single one of us falls short of the glory of God. So in other words, these scriptures tell us that we can't be good enough to get to heaven on our own. We can't be good enough. And no matter how hard we try, and trying hard was the root of Saul's problem. See, that was Saul of Tarsus' problem. He was trying hard. He was trying hard to follow all the rules and to follow all the law and to obey all the laws and all the commands. And as he was doing this, he tried to do this, and he had this problem until he faced Jesus Christ face to face on the road here. You see, Paul couldn't stand the followers of Christ. He couldn't stand Jesus' followers. He couldn't stand Christians. He couldn't stand anybody that was part of the way. He couldn't stand them because he was a self-righteous man. He was a self-righteous man, and he passionately did everything he could, all in the name of religion. All in the name of religion. So if religion is all you're after, you're going to come up short every single time. Amen? See, he did everything he did in the name of religion. Later on, the Apostle Paul, he shares with us why he was so confident in his religion. In Philippians 4:4-6, the Apostle Paul says this. He's addressing them, and he says, you know what? He says, if anybody has bragging rights, you know, on following the religious laws, he says, I have more bragging rights than anybody else. He says, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I'm a pure-blooded citizen of Israel and a member of the tribe of Benjamin, a real Hebrew if there ever was one. I was a member of the Pharisees who demanded the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church, and I was so right. And as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. Without fault. That means he followed it all. And some versions say that he was blameless. He was blameless. He took pride in following the law. As much as human possible, Saul of Tarsus, he kept the law. He loved the law. He obeyed the law. He lived the law. And Saul of Tarsus was an extremely religious man. And the problem with that was Saul put his faith solely in his good works. That's what Paul's problem was. He put his faith solely in his good works. It was all about what he was doing, and he was trusting in his obedience to the law to save his own soul. Saul thought that keeping the law would find favor with God, and that if he could just find favor with God, then God would accept him and grant him salvation because he had earned it. Because he had earned it in everything that he did. Guys, can I tell you that Saul's belief system couldn't have been farther from the truth? It couldn't have been farther from the truth at all. Saul's belief that he had everything, that he was doing everything right on the outside, couldn't erase the sin on his heart. It couldn't erase the sin on his heart. It couldn't cover up that he was born with sin on his heart, just like every single one of us. Have you ever had one of those stains in your garments? Maybe your kids come in with grass stain or something on that, and no matter how hard you scrubbed, no matter how hard you tried, you could not get that stain out. Sooner or later, you got to throw it away and replace it with a new one. Amen? See, we've got sin in our heart. We're sin-stained, and it's impossible for us to get rid of that. We need a new garment covering us, and that's the garment of the righteousness of Christ covering us. Amen? You see, this happened way back in the Garden of Eden when Adam sinned. Romans 5:12 says that sin entered into the world through one man, which was Adam, and death through sin, and in the way of death came to all people because all have sinned. So in other words, the Bible says that all the descendants of Adam, they've inherited sin in their life because of that one sin. That means everybody that's ever been born, everybody that will ever be born, including yourself, we're all sinners. We're all sinners, and there's nothing we can do on our own. You know, sin just comes natural for people, doesn't it? How many of you with toddlers and children, how many of you have had to teach your kids how to be bad? Comes naturally, doesn't it? Have you ever tried to teach them how to be selfish, how to say no? You haven't, have you? It comes natural. It comes natural in our life. You see, we don't become sinners when we sin. We're sin because we're sinners by nature. Amen? It's just who we are. And keeping the law ain't going to change a thing. Guys, religion without redemption always produces resentment. Always produces resentment. Have you ever been around somebody that's really religious? We can look down our nose at people, right? We can think that we've a little bit better and we can do things wrong and we can have resentment. You know, that was the case of Saul. That was the case of Saul here. Saul had heard the truth, but he rejected it. He didn't want to have any part of it. He was dead set that he was right, and he was furious over anybody that believed in Jesus Christ. And this self-righteous religious attitude caused him to be extremely a cruel, cruel man. It caused him to hate Jesus. It caused him to hate everything about him. It caused him to hate that Jesus claimed to be the Son of God. He hated that Jesus claimed to be the Messiah. He hated the gospel because it claimed that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and rose from the dead. Saul hated any talk of a man being the Savior because Paul believed that salvation came through strict obedience of the law, and it caused Saul to be calloused and blinded to his own sin and his own need for a Savior. Guys, Saul was breaking the very law that he was claiming to live by. And in fact, his self-righteous attitude caused him to be a really, really mean person. For those of you that don't know and aren't familiar with Saul of Tarsus, he took part of the stoning of Stephen, which Stephen was a very godly man. The Bible says that he made havoc among the church, meaning that he tried to destroy the church of God. He openly threatened believers. He forced believers to blaspheme God. And he also slandered the Lord himself. In a nutshell, Saul did everything that he could to oppose everything about Jesus Christ and Christianity. Listen, guys, Saul was so bad. He was so bad that when he got saved, the early believers didn't want to have anything to even do with Saul. Didn't even want to have anything to do because they didn't even know for sure, can God really change somebody like him? He was such a mean and terrible person. Can God really get a hold of him and change something like that? You know, maybe some of you all today can relate to Saul in one way or another. You know, maybe you can relate to Saul, maybe on the religious side of things. You know, maybe you believe that, you know what, my good will outweigh my bad. That I'm going to try to be good enough so I can earn my spot into heaven. You know, I've never done this or I've never done that, and I just try to be nice to people. I try to do what I'm supposed to do. And maybe if I just keep treating people nice, maybe if I just go to church enough, maybe if I just give to enough charities, maybe if I do enough good things, then maybe my good will outweigh my God. And hopefully I can just slide into heaven there and maybe just get a little shack in the corner of heaven. Have you ever heard anybody say that before? Maybe that's you today. Maybe you're here and you can identify yourself with the religious side of Paul, that you're just trying to be good enough. But maybe you're here today and you can relate to the bad side of Paul. You know, maybe you can sit there and look at your life and say, you know what? My past was terrible. My past was terrible. There's no way somebody like God can forgive me. After all the things that I've done, after all the things that I've done in the past, what my life looked like, all the bad decisions that I made, there's no way God can forgive me. There's no way. So you struggle with that. Can you relate to Saul's bad side? You know, no matter where you find yourself today, I have some good news and some bad news for you. I'm going to start off with the bad news and get that out of the way. The bad news is, it doesn't matter how good or bad you've been. You know, we're all in the same hopeless boat. We're all in the same hopeless boat. It doesn't matter whether you've broke the law just a little bit or whether you've done it really, really bad. We're all in the same hopeless boat. As I already said, because it's impossible to be good enough to earn our spot in heaven. Because God's standard is perfection. It's perfection. And since we've already admitted that we're all sinners and His standard is perfection, that means we can't make it to a holy God. Amen? So we got problems. We got problems and we're in a hopeless condition. Guys, from the bottom of my heart, the very mission of our church is to try to rescue people from taking their last breath without Jesus Christ. Can I tell you that if we take our last breath without Jesus, then we're going to die and we're going to go to hell. Oh, preacher, get over it. Quit preaching about hell. That's not very popular. I don't care whether it's popular. I'm here to preach truth. And I love you. I love you enough to tell you the truth. It's impossible for us to be good enough to make it to heaven. I don't care how bad or how good you are. We're all in the same boat, and we are hopeless, left on our own. And guys, until you understand that truth, then you say no. You see no need to have a Savior. You see no need to have a Savior in your life if you don't understand that you're hopeless without Him. Now let's move on to the good news, okay? And I'm not just talking about, like, okay, good news. It's actually the best good news that you'll ever hear and receive in your life. And it's number two in your outline. There is no one out of God's reach. Amen? There is no one out of God's reach, not even Saul of Tarsus. Not even Saul of Tarsus. All the things that Saul did, it didn't stop him from being used and connected by God. Here Saul was in our scripture today. He was on the way to Damascus to arrest believers. That's why he was going there. He was going there so he could haul women and men off and put them into prison because they believed in Jesus Christ. So here he is. He's ticked off. He's breathing murderous threats with every step that he took. And Saul, it was because he was a self-righteous, bitter person. But he ended up introducing himself, or Jesus introduced himself, and Saul was forever changed. And the cool thing about it, can I tell you, Saul wasn't even looking. Amen? Did you see that in the story there? Saul wasn't looking. He wasn't going out looking for God. He wasn't looking for a change in his life. He was just going about his business, doing his thing, getting ready to persecute the church, and he has this encounter with Jesus Christ himself. In verse 3 through 4, it says that Saul collided with God. The scripture says that as he's getting close to Damascus, this bright light fell on him, and Saul fell to the ground immediately, and he heard this voice from Jesus say, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And Saul said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you'll be told what you must do next." So in other words, Jesus said this. Let's bring it up into 2016. He said, "Dude, what are you doing? What are you doing? Don't you know that I'm real? Don't you know that I am the one when you're going out slandering me and doing your own thing in life? Don't you know that you're totally going against my plans for your life? Don't you know that you're completely going against the gospel and the life transformation that I want to do in your life?" He said, "Paul, wake up. You're destroying the church. You're living wrong. You're doing wrong." He said, "Wake up. I'm real. I'm the risen Jesus Christ, and I want to make a difference in every single one of your lives." And I believe that's what Paul heard. I believe he's seen that. And I believe one minute Saul was riding high, and the next moment he was knocked on the ground. Amen. The next moment he hit his knees, and he encountered Jesus in a way that made him come to a place of humble repentance. You know, I believe that at this point in Saul's life, I believe that he was so overwhelmed with the conviction of sin that all the thoughts of everything that he ever did, I believe, started flooding through his heart. I believe it started flooding through his mind, and everything started rushing through. All the killings that he was responsible for, all the beatings that he was responsible for, all the persecutions that he was responsible for, all the dragging people off into prison that he was responsible for, all the children that he left homeless. He left them homeless because he took their moms and dads away from them. All the evil thoughts, all the words, all this had to come rushing to his mind. I guarantee you, Paul thought, "Wow, what have I done? What have I done with my life that God's given me? You know, here I've tried to obey the rules, and I was blinded to my own sin. I was blinded to the very thing that God was wanting to do in my life." I believe that Saul was convicted, and just like that, his life was changed forever. His life was completely changed. God's grace is truly amazing. God's grace is truly amazing. You know, for God to take someone like Saul, one of the worst sinners of all time. You know, even by Paul's own admission in 1 Timothy 1:15, it says, here is a trustworthy saying, Paul says, that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. Do you look at your life and do you think, man, I am the worst? I am the worst and I need God. I need God's grace. I need His mercy. I need His love. I need God to touch me. You know, God took a man like Saul, even when he wasn't looking and even when he wasn't deserving, and he offered him love. He offered him grace, mercy, and forgiveness. You know what that tells me? It tells me that there's absolutely hope for the hopeless. Amen? There's hope for the hopeless. And when I say hopeless, I'm talking about the way our world sees people. For hopeless situations, I believe that there's hope. And I also believe that it means that there's no one out of God's reach. God can reach a hold of every single one of us if we would let Him. Guys, I believe that God wants to do the same to you today. Have you ever had your Damascus Road experience? Have you ever met Jesus on the Damascus Road? And maybe it was on the way here. You know, I believe that there's a time in your life, you know, you might not see the bright light shining like Paul did. You know, you're probably not going to hear the audible voice of the Lord Jesus. But I do believe that there's a time where you're faced with your life and the reality of life and what God wants to do with your life. And all of a sudden, there's going to be a time where you understand Jesus in such a deeper way, where you are overwhelmed by the love of God, how He could love a sinner like me. And I believe that you're so overwhelmed with the conviction that you understand that you need God's grace. That you'd understand you need His grace, you need His love and His mercy, and a time in your life where you say, wow, boy, I've really messed things up. I've messed things up, and God, I completely give you my life. I believe that you died on the cross for me. I believe that you rose from the grave, and I believe that you love me. And God, I give you my life. You know, if you have not made that decision, then don't leave here today without making that decision. Because number three in your outline, when you collide with God, you're forever changed. Amen. When you collide with God, you're forever changed. You know, when Saul got up off the ground, he was never the same again. Isn't that a pretty cool story? You know, here Saul is, he's doing his own thing, getting ready to do something really bad. He sees Jesus face to face, he collides with him, he goes down, and he gets up, and he's never changed, he's never the same again. He's been totally transformed. This brief encounter with the Lord Jesus, that mean, terrible, self-righteous, religious man, was totally transformed from the inside out. You know, from that moment on, Saul began to do whatever it is that God wanted him to do. He started following after God, and whatever it is, whenever, wherever, that's what Paul did. And Paul went around, and his life completely changed. From that moment on, you know, Jesus commanded Saul to blindly. See, he blinded him for 3 days, so Paul couldn't even see. So he blindly went into the city for 3 days with absolutely no direction. But he got up, and he followed after God. And then he was sent a man to teach him, to help him grow in the Lord. And Saul did everything the Lord commanded him, and continued to until the day he died. And not because he had to in order to be saved, right? He didn't do what he had to do. He didn't do what he was doing in order to win brownie points with God. He did what he did because he understood the love of God. He understood that God loved him. And you know what? Because of God's love, I want to glorify Him with my life. See, if you have to do what you do just to be a set of rules to follow, then that's all it'll ever be to you. But once you experience true salvation, true transformation happens because I'm living a life out of obedience and I'm living my life for God. I love Him and I want my life to look different. And that's what was going on in Saul's life. He was forever changed. Once he hated believers and now he seeks their fellowship. Once he hated the truth and now he lives by truth. Once he hated the gospel and now he preaches the gospel. Once he was a terrorist and now he's an evangelist. Once he's called Saul and now he's called Paul. And Paul was a new man. Everything about Paul was different. As soon as Paul got saved, he began to serve the Lord and began preaching the gospel. He ended up taking full advantage of every platform that God gave him. Every single place that he put him, he used it as a platform. Do you use every place that God's given you as a platform to share the love of Christ? My guess is a lot of times we probably don't, right? I believe that God wants us to be faithful in the workplace. I believe He wants us to be faithful amongst our families. I believe He wants our lives to be different and to be vocal when it comes to our faith with Jesus. God used Paul in a remarkable way, and Paul used every single place he found himself in as a platform to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the world. He traveled thousands of miles to tell governors and kings and soldiers and common men and women about the good news of Jesus Christ. He would tell them how Jesus died and rose again and saved him. He would tell them about his love and grace and mercy. He would tell them verbally, and he would also tell them in writing. Paul went on to write a third of the New Testament. That's pretty cool how God used the Apostle Paul. He started churches all over the known world, and he endured terrible suffering for the cause of Christ. He was beaten, he was shipwrecked, he was stoned, and he was left for dead, and he spent many years chained to a Roman soldier in prison, all because he preached Jesus. Do you think Paul was totally transformed? Do you think God took a man like Paul that couldn't have been farther from a Christian and totally transformed his life, impacted him, collided with him, and forever changed? You know, I think if God could do that for Paul, don't you think he could do that for you today? Don't you think he could take your life, no matter what that looks like, no matter how good you're trying to offset your bad, no matter how bad your life's been, don't you think he can take that and to turn it around? I'm going to ask the praise team to come on up. Guys, the very heartbeat of every single thing that we do as a church is because we desperately desire people to collide with God. We desperately desire for you to understand the truth of who He is. We desperately desire to you to be impacted by God in a way that's going to make a huge impact. Guys, I believe that God wants to use you. I believe if he could use somebody like the Apostle Paul and he can change their lives and transform their lives, then I believe that he can take us and he can transform our lives. I believe that there's nobody here today that's out of the reach of God. And in fact, right now, if you're breathing, are you guys breathing? Some of you are about to pass out with the heat. So you better meet Jesus now, right? If you're still breathing, then I believe you're not out of the reach of God. I believe that God is, you're here today, and maybe some of you are here thinking that, you know what, the only reason I'm here today is because one of my friends twisted my arm and grabbed me and talked me into this, and that's the only reason I'm here. Can I tell you, I don't believe that at all. You know why you're here? Your friend might have twisted your arm and grabbed you, but maybe you're here today and you're just like the Apostle Paul. You wasn't even looking for God. But you know what? God was looking for you. He was looking for you, and he found you. He found you right here. So it's a matter whether you're going to turn and run away like you've always done, or whether you're just going to go ahead and give it to God. Pastor, I know that you said that God will forgive us and there's nobody out of his grasp, but you really honestly don't have any idea what I've done with my life and what I'm living right now. I don't care. God loves you. You're not here by accident. You're here because God was looking for you and he used somebody to get you here. See, God's into life change. He's into transformation. He's into making you brand new and forever changed. That's the whole reason he came here. That's the whole reason he came to this life, and he lived his life perfect and sinless. And he laid his life down on the cross to take the punishment for our sins. And then he conquered death by raising from the grave, and whoever believes in him will be saved. Guys, Jesus came to set you free from the bondage of this life and the sin that so easily entangles you and keeps you from being everything that God wants you to be. Do you know when Jesus Christ began his earthly ministry, when Jesus stepped onto the scene, it says that he went into the synagogue the first thing, and they handed him a scroll. And he opened up the scroll, and he opened it up to Isaiah. And this is what he read. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim the freedom for the prisoners and to recover the sight of the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then the Bible says that he rolled up the scroll and he sat down, and everybody was looking at him completely amazed. They were looking at him amazed, wondering who he was. And you know what he said? He looked at him and he said, today that prophecy's been fulfilled. Today I fulfilled that prophecy. He came and begun this life to set the captives free. Can I tell you that Jesus fulfilled that prophecy then, and he has been for the last 2,000 years in every single people's life. As people collide with him, they're transformed forever and they're forever changed. He becomes a father to the fatherless. He's hope for the hopeless. He lifts the depressed out of the pit. He dries up the alcoholic. He breaks the chains of the drug addict. He tames the tongue of the gossiper. He calms the temper of the angry. He curbs the appetite of the glutton, and he turns the eyes of the lustful. He controls the passions of the fornicator, and he changes the desires of the homosexual. He rebuilds the broken homes, and he mends the strained relationships. He heals the hurting marriages. He brings dawn to the darkness. He quenches the thirsty, and he defends the defenseless. He stands beside the adulterer, and he challenges the religious. He answers the questioner, and he calls the faithless, and he feeds the hungry. He seeks the lost, and he becomes passionate for the passionless. He stimulates the bored, and he makes the comfortable uncomfortable. He shows the worthless their true worth, and he breathes life into the dry bones. He binds up the brokenhearted, and he doctors the sick. He wipes the tears of the mourner, and he values the aborted. He gives life to the murderer, and he renews a broken spirit. He's strength to the weak, and he is endurance for the tired. He crushes the head of the serpent, and he turns the upside down, right side up. And he makes the blind see and the lame walk. And he makes the deaf hear, and he clothes the naked. And he guides the directionless, and he makes strangers a family. He makes enemies friends, and he comforts the distressed. He reorders the priorities, and he welcomes the wayward. He reestablishes trust, and he takes away pain. He burns away excess, and he erases the burden. He gives peace to the worried mind, and he brings joy to the depressed. He gives contentment to the envious, and he makes the prideful humble. He makes the manipulator moldable, and he makes the liar speak truth. He makes the cheater honest, and he makes the hoarder want him alone. And he blows the mind of the intelligent, and he takes the eyes off the screen and puts them on him. He gives focus to the distracted, and he makes the complainer grateful. He gives patience to the impatient, and he's at home in the homeless. He soothes the stress, and he makes beauty from ashes. He turns the head of the unimpressed, and he's a winner for the loser. And he can do this because Jesus just isn't anyone. He's the Almighty One, the Advocate, the Author, and the Perfecter of faith. He's the Authority, the Bread of Life, the Beloved Son of God. He's the Bridegroom, the Chief Cornerstone, the Deliverer, the Faithful True. He's the Good Shepherd, the Good High Priest. He's the head of the church, the holy servant, Emmanuel, indescribable gift. He's the judge, the Lamb of God. He's the light of the world, the light of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lord of all, the mediator, the Messiah, the mighty one, the one who sets us free. He's our hope. He's our peace. He's our prophet. He's our redeemer. He's our risen Lord. He's the rock. He's our sacrifice for our sins. He's our savior. He's the son of man. He's the son of the most high. He's supreme creator over all. He's the resurrection of life, the door, the way, the word, the true vine, the truth, the victorious one, the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, the Alpha Omega. He is and was and always will be the great I Am, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Jesus is the name above all names, and he alone is worthy to be praised, because Jesus is Jesus. Jesus wants to transform every single one of our lives. There's not a single person that is out of the grip of God. There's not a single person that can't be changed. There's not a single person that has sinned too much that God can't bring back. There's not a single person here that God doesn't want to use. There's not a single person here that God wants you to shut up and not speak about his love. Every single one of us has got a calling on our life. Every single one of us. It's just not the preacher. It's just not the worship leader. It's just not the pastors. It's just not the Bible study leaders and teachers and organizers. It's not the people in full-time ministry. It's every single one of us. Do you know that everybody out here, everybody in this town expects the hired guns to tell people about Jesus? That's our job. The real people are you. You're the church. You're the ones that's going to reach people that we can't reach. I can't reach the people at the factory, the construction workers, the secretaries, the teachers, all the people that God's put you in the middle of doing, the trash men, whatever it is in life. We are to be faithful. And when God's got a hold of your life, when he's changed you from the inside out, when you become totally transformed, then you can't shut up. You can't shut up. It's impossible to shut up. You look around this place right now. Look at all the people that are here. We haven't even scratched the surface. God's given us 9.1 acres. It's his land. It's not ours. And he is going to continue to grow it. He's going to continue to reach people. And people's lives are going to be forever changed. It's the greatest story of all. And it's not a fake story. It's real. It's supernatural. Amen. Amen. I want us to rise on our feet. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in his name for every chain that holds on to you to fall away and to be gone, whatever that is. During this song, I'm going to give a couple of instructions. For those that are getting baptized today, I want you to come on up and make your way here. Pastor Kelly and Angie is going to meet you up here. Pastor Mark's going to be up here if anybody needs to accept Jesus today. But I want us to close our eyes and bow our heads for just a second, because this is real important right here today, guys. I want to ask you this question. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Has your life been truly transformed? Has there been a time in your life where you saw Jesus, not physically, but you saw him touch your life and change you as you gave your life to him? Has there been a time in your life where you become totally transformed and the old life is dead? The stain of sin is covered by the righteousness of Christ. Has there ever been a time in your life where you've done that? If not, then today's the day. Today's the day for that. Raise up your hand and say, Pastor, that's me. I want to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Would you raise up your hand? I see you. Anybody else, raise up your hand. I see hands going up. Anyone else? Don't put it off. This is your road to Damascus. You might not have been looking for God, but he found you. Praise God. Amen. Let's say this prayer together. Say, Dear God, I love you. I believe in you. I believe in your son, Jesus. I believe he died on the cross for my sins. I ask you to forgive me. Come into my life. Save me. Fill me with your spirit. Help me to live my life for you. I give you everything. I want to be changed forever. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.